Now sitting at the Francis X. Bellotti Courthouse, Quincy Law D. Draw near, give your attendance, and you shall be heard. God save the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The Honorable Mark Colvin. The Honorable Paula Carey. The Honorable Paul Dolly. The Honorable Kevin Cunningham is presiding. Law Day is now in session. Remain standing, please.
Thank you for the invitation. Let us pray. Almighty God, who brought order from chaos and in your abundant love, guide creation in wisdom, justice, and truth, we gather in your name asking your blessing on the celebration of the rule of law upheld throughout our nation and on those who have dedicated their lives to its continuation. Bless and guide all who serve in public safety and administrative authority in the Commonwealth, especially our Governor Baker. Bestow your wisdom and blessing on the courts of justice and its magistrates in our state and in our city of Quincy, especially Justice Colvin and the honored justices of this court. We ask you to strengthen and protect our valued public servants in the local, state, environmental, and MBTA police departments as they seek to protect us. Always keep them safe in the power of your love. Bless and guide the honorees today as they accept our acknowledgement of their particular gifts and our gratitude for their service and integrity. Be always present as collectively we renew our commitment to protect the freedoms of all by upholding the justice system that makes that possible. In you, God, all things have their beginning, continuation, and end. Grace us with your saving presence, aid us with your constant help, and let us glorify you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Could we have Chief Keenan, the Quincy Police Department, please, to lead everyone in the Pledge of Allegiance of the flag with colors? The colors are back here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
To bring us the greetings of our host city, the great city of Quincy, I'm pleased to call forward the chairman of the city council, president of the city council, Kirsten Hughes. Ms. Hughes, please.
The mayor asked me to convey his best wishes for a wonderful day for everyone, and I also bring those greetings from the city council. We're very pleased and very proud and honored to have the Quincy District Court here, not only because it is such a huge part of the fabric of our city and is instrumental in keeping us safe and protecting us, but also because the District Court here is such a great partner with the community in terms of helping work through many community issues, obviously affecting so many communities here across Massachusetts. So we thank the District Court here. We certainly thank Justice Colvin and the clerk, Mr. Clerk, and all of the wonderful attorneys and probation officers and court officers and everyone here who works day in and day out to keep us safe and protect us. So thank you very much, and greetings and welcome to Quincy here today.
This time I'm pleased to call forward the president of the Quincy Bar Association, Tom, give me a clue. Tom Cavanaugh, who will make the Law Day motion. Mr. Cavanaugh, please.
Now comes the Quincy Bar Association, and through its president, respectfully request that this honorable court suspend today's proceedings for the observance of Law Day, focusing on the theme, the 14th Amendment, transforming American democracy. 3 years after the Civil War, a fight for political and economic unity, Congress provided the mechanism for which we fight for legal unity. This amendment dictated that protection and enforcement of the most basic and fundamental rights would not be limited by the state which you lived, the color of your skin, or the economic class which you came from. Put simply, the 14th Amendment was a uniform recognition of humanity. In order for us to flourish as a society, it is of the utmost importance that we endlessly pursue not just the idea of all created equal, but the practical application of that idea as well. 14th Amendment as our sword and shield. Each thrust of the Due Process Clause or Equal Protection Clause takes us a step in the right direction. We, of course, have an awfully long way to go in guaranteeing these principles. Speaking of the mindless menace of violence, the day after Martin Luther King was assassinated, Robert F. Kennedy noted, another kind of violence, slower but just as deadly, destructive as a shot or bomb in the night. This is the violence of institutions, indifference, inaction, and slow decay. Each Supreme Court decision that enforces and furthers the guarantees within the 14th Amendment strips away this decay, encourages action, and rewards those who fight for the rights of others. Kennedy went on to say, we can perhaps remember, even if only for a time, that those who live with us are our brothers, that they share with us the same sort of movement of life that they seek, as we do, nothing but the chance to live out their lives in purpose and in happiness, winning what satisfaction and fulfillment they can. Today we celebrate this caseless endeavor in the passage of the amendment which made it possible. Wherefore, the Quincy Bar Association prays that this honorable court direct proceedings be suspended for today's presentation of a program that celebrates the transformation of the American democracy, equal access to the laws in the 14th Amendment.
The motion is allowed. We're going into the rest of it.
So next, the Quincy Bar Association this year is presenting three awards. We'll be presenting those awards at the annual dinner. This year it's going to be held on Wednesday, May 24th at 6 o'clock. That's going to be at the Terrell Room in Quincy. The first award, which is a special award, is the Peter J. Muse Award. This award is named for one of the all-time great Quincy lawyers. He was a mentor to most and a friend to all. Peter truly embodied and understood the definition of humanity. This year, that award's going to be given to none other than the Justice of the District Court, Paul Dolly, who's with us here today. Justice Dolly truly understands humanity as Peter did. He's on the front lines of the opioid addiction crisis that we have today. He started as a justice of the district court. He then became the first justice of the Brockton District Court. He was a regional administrative justice, and we are lucky to have him in the district court as the first justice of the district courts. We would ask that you all come that night so we can formally present that award to a recipient that truly does deserve it, who is cut from the same cloth as Peter is. The next award is going to be given to three people this year. Three beloved members of the Quincy District Court Clerk's Office. This year we're given that award for distinguished service. These three people have a combined service of 119 years in the Quincy District Court. To put that into perspective, Mr. Bloom has 44 years of service in the Quincy District Court. When Mr. Bloom started in this court, I was negative six. That type of service is just profound. Mr. Dalton, I was negative one. And Ms. Alexander, I was 2 years old when you started here. This type of service is just, you just don't see this. And the amount of people that they've helped, they truly do deserve this award. And we look forward to presenting them that award on the 24th. The last award is for the Public Service of the Bar Advocate Award. This year, it's going to actually a former president of the Quincy Bar Association, Phyllis Field. Phyllis Field truly is a part of the fabric of the Quincy District Court. She's been here as long as I've been here, and she might have been here as long as Mr. Bloom's been here. She has helped countless people, whether criminal defendants, families, juveniles. She's helped many young lawyers too. She's provided countless hours of speaking to young lawyers about some of the issues that come up when you start doing criminal defense work. So we'd ask that you, if you're able to all come on the 24th, we look forward to seeing you all, and thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Mark Colvin, the presiding judge of the Quincy District Court. On behalf of Clerk Magistrate Arthur Tobin, Chief Probation Officer Jay Brennan, I want to welcome you to the Francis X. Bellotti Courthouse for this event today. We have a number of distinguished public officials, elected and appointed officials, who I just want to recognize this morning. Please don't applaud. The list is very long. All these officials generally come every year. Just because the governor is here, maybe there's a few more today. But obviously, the governor of the Commonwealth, Charles Baker, Secretary of Public Safety, Dan Bennett, the State Police Colonel, Richard McKean, State Police Lieutenant Colonel Frank Hughes, Senator John Keenan from Quincy, Senator Walter Timmelty, is back there, State Representative Tacky Chan, State Representative Bruce Ayers, slipped in the back, Lon Povich, Governor's Legal Counsel. From the trial court, John Williams, our new court administrator. I believe the Commissioner of Probation, Ed Dalton, is here. He's on his way, okay. Clerk Magistrate of the Dedham District Court, our friend Sal Paterna. From the county, we have the District Attorney of Middlesex County, Mike Morrissey, who you'll be hearing from today. I don't know if I saw Joe Shea. There's Joe in the back. County Commissioner. I do want to just take a moment to recognize someone who can't be with us today, but who was a very dear friend of the court, who passed away this weekend, former County Commissioner John Gillis, who gave so much both to the city of Quincy and to the Norfolk County, and we remember him today. I do want to recognize the people who are on the bench with me and the other judges who are here today. To my left is Chief Justice Paula Carey. To her left is Chief Justice Paul Dolly. In front is Regional Administrative Judge Kevin Cunningham. And these are all judges in the front row here: Dan O'Malley, Diane Moriarty, Paula Clifford, Linda Sable, Mary Orfanello, Mary Beth Heffernan, and Siobhan Foley. Thank you all for being here. The chiefs of police from all our jurisdictions: Chief Paul Shastany from Braintree, Chief Quigley from Cohasset, Chief Smith from Holbrook, Chief King from Milton, Chief Keenan from Quincy, Chief Pace from Randolph, Chief Grimes from Weymouth. I also want to recognize Robert Jubenville, Governor's Counselor from this area. There's a number of elected and appointed officials. Joe Sullivan, the Mayor of Braintree, is here. Town Manager Dave Murphy from Randolph, Town Administrator Michael Dennehy from Milton, Town Councilor Jim Burgess from Randolph, Town Councilor Tim Bowes from Braintree, City Councilor Margaret LaForest I saw in back, City Councilor Hughes, you've met already, Dr. Frank Hackett, Braintree Superintendent of Schools, Tom Anderson, the Randolph Superintendent of Schools. There are some honored guests who you will be hearing about their families today, but I recognize them every year and I thank them for being here. Elaine Spillane, Charlotte Dana, Anne-Marie Charbonnier, Stephen Charbonnier. And finally, and most importantly, since the building is named after him, I want to introduce and welcome Francis X. Bellotti, the former Attorney General of the Commonwealth, whose building this is named for. So thank you all very much for being here. If I missed anyone, it's because you didn't RSVP and you didn't make the list, though. So next year, you'll know. So thank you all. Mr. Bloom.
The Robert Dana Distinguished Service Award is awarded to police officers for service on and above the course of duty. To make these awards, I'm pleased to call forward the District Attorney of Norfolk County, Michael Morrissey. Mr. Morrissey, please.
Your Honors, and to the three retiring clerks, I want to say we, District Attorney's Office, most appreciate the years of service and the courtesies you've extended to the office over many years of service. But I was alive when you guys were working, so. I do have, I'll ask the governor shortly to join me. We have five departments that are being recognized. As many of you know, it's my privilege to award the Dana Awards this year. And as many people in this room know too well, Metropolitan District Police Officer Dana was shot and killed on Blue Hill Parkway by a suspect who gained control of a different officer's weapon in the course of a traffic stop. It was 33 years ago, but it seems like yesterday. It started out as a routine matter, the kind of interaction that happens in every police department on every shift. And for that reason, it's a great reminder of the danger that police officers willingly face each day that they report for duty. When they're working alone in the presence of other officers, they're called to an active scene or conducting a routine operations. The police officers who will now be called forward in groups or by departments are being recognized today for examples of particularly meritorious police work, but also in recognition of the valor associated with volunteering to put themselves in harm's way, not once, but as a way of life. When I called the departments and the recipients up and asked the chiefs as well if they could join me, the first one is the Branchy Police Department. I'd like to ask Detective James Peters to step forward. As we look out in this room, I see people who are spending part of every day trying to stem the tide of the opiate addiction on the South Shore and the destruction and death it's causing. 3.5 people a week die in Norfolk County alone. From the judges, the clerks, or probation officials who operate the drug court session, to the ADAs, the defense attorneys who work to get addicted defendants the treatment and supervision they need. But as a region pours resources and passion into intervention and prevention, we also need officers like Detective Peters on the street targeting supply of drugs in our towns, our homes, our cars, and our schools. Beginning in September of last year, Detective Peters, who serves on the DEA's regional task force, was the primary affiant and the police officer coordinating a narcotics investigation that would build out for months, culminating on December 15th. That morning, before dawn, the FBI, Boston Police, Branchy Police, Watertown Police conducted raids in three counties. Over 80,000 in apparent drug cash was seized, 10 firearms, 5.5 kilograms of heroin and fentanyl, and 50 parties were arrested. The battle to stop the opiate epidemic has been fought across three fronts: education, prevention, interdiction. And Detective Peters, we thank you for your distinguished service and your work. And I know, Governor, you've made this a priority as well, and we thank you for coming here today. Would you please join us for a quick photo?
Mr. Morrison.
Glad to see that this is the tall guy's view.
From the Holbrook Police Department, I now ask Holbrook officers Andrew Martins and Brian McGregor to join me. On the evening of April 29th, officers McGregor and Martins were dispatched to a Holbrook home for report of an armed suicidal male. They were initially denied entry. Through their training experience, these officers were able to talk their way into the residence, avoiding the escalation that would come from forced entry. Inside, they were confronted by a suicidal male holding a knife to his own throat. It was a tense and volatile situation that had the potential to turn deadly within a moment's notice for the officers or the subjects. Even so, through their calm, professional demeanor, the proper use of defensive tactics, they are able to disarm the individual without causing injury or sustaining injury to themselves. Through their patient, professional application of the training and experience, they preserved the subject's life and were able to deliver him to much-needed treatment and supportive medical intervention, and hopefully a positive long-term recovery from his period of crisis. Gentlemen, congratulations on a job well done. Quincy, I ask Officer Tara Waters to come forward. On February 26th of this year, Officer Waters responded to an emergency call for stabbing in a local karaoke bar. She was the first to arrive and was met outside by a man who told her the stabbing victim was inside, but the whereabouts of the assailant was unknown. She entered the building to see a woman on the ground in a large pool of blood. A civilian, using a wad of napkins, was trying to stem the flow of blood from the area of her neck. Officer Ward is still unsure of the location and the identity of the assailant, took over applying pressure to the wound while calling an ambulance and updating dispatch as to the critical nature of the wound. Upon removing the first wad of napkins, Officer Ward has realized an additional serious wound to the woman's left arm. She was able to apply a tourniquet to the arm above the wound. As the victim began losing consciousness, along with large amounts of blood, she was placed on a stretcher and finally transported to the ambulance as Officer Waters continued to apply pressure. She continued the task while the ambulance personnel cut away the victim's clothing to search for additional wounds. The victim was transported to a level one trauma center and eventually surgery. Officer Waters followed the ambulance to the hospital, gathered the victim's blood-soaked clothing and personal belongings to preserve the evidence, then turned them over to the detective's unit. Notwithstanding the possible presence of an armed assailant, with disregard for her own safety and without losing sight of the need to collect and preserve evidence, Officer Waters used her training and experience to save the life of a victim. Congratulations on a job well done. The Randolph Police Department. I now ask Randolph Police Chief, Police Officers Douglas Morgan and Officer Duong Tran to join me. And the Chief I know is here as well, Chief Pace. On the evening of May 16th, Officers Morgan and Tran were dispatched to a volatile domestic violence call with a man reportedly beating a woman inside a Chevrolet Impala parked in a driveway on North Main Street. When they arrived, the officer immediately charged by a man holding a sizable black knife. Both officers retreated to create distance with the suspect while they drew their service weapons in response to imminent deadly threat from the charging subject. The subject was shouting, "Go ahead and shoot me. I'm going to jail. I'm going to kill you," along with a rageful string of expletives. The officers were forced to retreat into North Main Street, which was heavily trafficked at the time, creating additional threat to their own personal safety. Officer Morgan, observing that Officer Tran had his service weapon in hand, quickly switched to his taser and immediately deployed it, striking the subject in the abdomen. It took two uses of the taser to disable the subject, at which time he was placed in handcuffs. The knife was recovered. They learned from the domestic violence victim that the subject had stated that if you go after the police with a knife, they have to kill you. Thanks to the steady professionalism of these officers, the utilization of their training and non-lethal means in the face of clear use of deadly force incident, the armed man was disarmed, taken to custody without the loss of life. Thank you for your distinguished service. The Weymouth Police Department. I ask that Officers Brian Healy and Stephen Goslin of the Weymouth Police Department and the Chief please join me. Just after 5 a.m. on May 3rd, Officers Healy and Goslin arrived on Colonel's Drive to the site of smoke pouring out of a multi-story apartment building with numerous tenants. Without protective gear or breathing apparatus, both officers disregarded their personal safety and entered the building to begin evacuation of residents. Many were children. Others had disabilities and mobility problems. One tenant was wheelchair-bound and needed to be carried to safety. They maintained contact with each other, with dispatch, and miraculously, no one was seriously injured. Despite experiencing smoke inhalation symptoms themselves, both officers remained on the scene following their successful evacuation to continue to help others. Your actions that day reflect great personal courage, dedication to your duty, and dedication to the citizen of Weymouth. It is my privilege to present you with the 2017 Robert P. Danner Award for Outstanding Law Enforcement.
Mr. Morrissey, while you're handing out the awards, like to note that Chief Grimes pulled the hat trick with the Dana Award, receiving it as a patrolman, as a sergeant, and as a lieutenant.
It's my privilege to now ask Assistant District Attorney Peter Tilley to join me for the Timothy J. Splain Outstanding District Court Prosecutor Award, named for a long time Quincy District Court Chief in the Norfolk County District Attorney's Office. And is Mr. Splain here? Well before my time, but I'm sure in Bob's time, Tim Splain served as a mentor to countless new prosecutors as they grew in their positions. He made himself invaluable to the office by asking much of himself and offering much of himself to the attorneys and colleagues around him. He was taken from us too young at the age of 51. It's my privilege this year to give the award to Peter Tilley. Peter started with the office after graduating law school, but before taking the bar exam. During that time, he was instrumental in assisting the office in our response to the Hinton-Dukin drug lab crisis. Since November of 2013, Peter has been an assistant district attorney assigned to the Quincy District Court and the Stoughton District Court. He's done a rotation in the domestic violence session at Quincy District Court, an often difficult assignment that he's performed with compassion and confidence. He has recently joined the motor vehicle homicide team, as we lose one person every week in this county to a motor vehicle homicide. Peter has also been stepping up as the interim supervisor of the Quincy District Court, while several senior ADAs assigned to this courthouse have been on leave. He's juggling case supervision, personnel matters, and his own caseload with poise and professionalism. He was able to do this because of the respect he's garnered from his peers. Peter brings to the job and to the work the qualities that we all want in a prosecutor: hard work, diligence, intellect, preparation, and compassion. And Peter understands that defendants are not just docket numbers, they're people whose lives will be shaped for many years by decisions we make in this court. But most importantly, Peter understands that victims are not an afterthought in the process. They are the reason we get up every morning to do this work. And it's my pleasure to congratulate Peter and to present the award to him.
I'd like to begin this morning by congratulating all our honorees and their families. And I'd like to join in echoing the sentiments of First Justice Colvin and offer a special thank you to His Excellency the Governor. We're well aware of your busy schedule, Governor, and for you to take time out to be with us today, along with our Chief Justice of the Trial Court, Justice Carey, our Chief Justice of the District Court, Paul Dolly, and our Regional Judge, Judge Cunningham, and all our honorable judges over here, all our chiefs of police, members of the court staff, members of the Bar Association. By your attendance here this morning, you honor us, you honor Law Day, and you honor the Quincy District Court, and for that we thank you. The Trooper Mark Charbonnier Meritorious Service Award. Mark Charbonnier Meritorious Service Award honors the memory of an outstanding young Massachusetts State Trooper who was fatally wounded in the line of duty. Mark's last day before suffering his life-ending wound was spent visiting his friends at the Quincy District Court. The staff, the police prosecutors, and his longtime friend and classmate, Trooper Ken Halloran. Each year on Law Day, we remember Mark, and we appreciate the faithful attendance and support of Mark's wife, Anne Marie, the members of the Charbonnier family, and accompanying Anne Marie this morning, her brother, Stephen Charbonnier, and Anne Marie's good friend, Massachusetts State Trooper Lynn Mulkerin. Could I please have the following people come forth and assist in the presentation? Detective Lieutenant Kenneth Halloran, Massachusetts State Police. commanding officer and colonel of the Massachusetts State Police, Colonel McEwen, please. And a dear friend of the Quincy District Court and an excellent trial attorney, the Secretary of Public Safety, Daniel Bennett, please.
He's encouraging you to get out of the office.
Each year on Law Day, we remember Mark and appreciate the faithful attendance. On Law Day, the Mark Charbonnier Meritorious Service Award is presented to that Massachusetts State Trooper who by his deeds best exemplifies those qualities exhibited by Trooper Charbonnier: professionalism, dedication, and courage in the line of duty. This year's Charbonnier Award recipient is Massachusetts State Police Detective Lieutenant Stephen McDonald. Steve McDonald, please. Steve McDonald is a true son of Quincy. Steve was born in Quincy, raised in Quincy, and educated in the Quincy public school system. He graduated from Quincy High School and went on to earn a Bachelor of Science degree in engineering from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Steve was always a serious student, focused, inquisitive, and always attentive to detail. These characteristics served him well to become a successful engineer and eventually an outstanding Massachusetts State Police officer. Notwithstanding his professional success, he always wanted to be a state trooper. When Steve felt the time was right, he made the important decision to make a career change, and he has never regretted that decision. During his long and expansive career with the Massachusetts State Police, his being inquisitive and paying attention to detail caught the attention of his superiors. And for 24 years of his distinguished 31-year career, Steve has served in the detective units of the Norfolk County District Attorney's Office, Suffolk County District Attorney's Office, and Essex County District Attorney's Office, investigating homicides and other serious crimes, and was promoted to the rank he presently holds today, Detective Lieutenant, Massachusetts State Police. Detective Lieutenant McDonald established himself as the go-to guy, the investigator that other investigators counted on for assistance in their cases. He was the lead investigator and assisted other detectives in over 200 homicides and thousands of suspicious or unattended deaths during his illustrious career. When assigned to the Essex County District Attorney's Office, he was appointed the executive officer of the homicide unit with the authority to designate and supervise other investigators. One of his most challenging cases occurred on September 27, 2011. Detective Lieutenant McDonald was notified that an Ipswich restaurant owner of the Magic Dragon, known as Tony Wu, was brutally murdered in his place of business. Detective Lieutenant McDonald noticed that Mr. Wu was a resident of the city of Quincy, and as the executive officer, he assigned himself to the case. The crime scene was described as a case of whodunit. Detective Lieutenant McDonald led the investigation and assigned his investigators to five different states to secure and preserve physical, electronic, and testimonial evidence that led to the identification and the arrest and prosecution of the killers of Tony Wu. During a series of trials and 5 years later, Detective Lieutenant McDonald presented evidence that the three alleged killers that included testimony from a third party source that Detective Lieutenant McDonald was able to cultivate by his experience as an investigator. This information obtained highlighted the entire crime scene from the planning phase to the actual homicide, including an attempt to destroy evidence, most of which he'd recovered. Additionally, he was able to obtain electronic evidence from a vehicle used in the murder and presented to the court in a way that had never been presented before the court of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. All three alleged killers were brought to justice and convicted. This proud son of Quincy is recognized and respected by his police colleagues as an elite investigator and a proud Massachusetts state trooper. Detective Lieutenant McDonald, by his deeds, best exemplifies those qualities exemplified by Trooper Mark Charbonnier. Detective Lieutenant McDonald's professionalism, tenacious dedication to duty, and courage to persevere directly helped secure justice for Tony Wu's family. The Quincy District Court proudly presents the 2017 Trooper Mark Charbonnier Meritorious Service Award to Quincy's own native, Massachusetts State Police Lieutenant Detective Stephen McDonald. We are very honored this morning to have the members of the Wu family with us. Would you please stand up and be recognized, please? And we're very proud to have Anne Marie Charbonnier and her brother Steve. Could you please stand up, please? The James R. McIntyre Humanitarian Award. James R. McIntyre was a proud son of a Quincy police captain. He had distinguished himself as a decorated combat Marine officer, mayor of Quincy, state representative, state senator, and legal counsel to the Massachusetts State Senate. Throughout his career, he was a strong advocate for the Massachusetts court system, for public safety officials, veterans, and for the needy and less fortunate in our society. To honor his memory and in appreciation for his advocacy for the betterment of his fellow man, the Quincy District Court established the James R. McIntyre Humanitarian Award to be presented each year on Law Day to those individuals who by their deeds best exemplify a selfless contribution in service to the others. Could I please have Chris and Susan Ely, please? And Chief Probation Officer Jay Brennan, please. I have asked Chief Brennan to assist this morning because Chris is a 22-year veteran of the probation department, and we wanted to recognize that. The 2017 McIntyre Humanitarian honorees are Christopher and Susan Ely, President and Treasurer of the Quincy Youth Basketball Program. In the 1900s, as loving and caring parents, Chris and Susan enrolled their two young children in a basketball program at St. Mary's School in West Quincy, and they immediately, with others, became aware and actively involved in the program, wanting more for the student athletes and working together with a few concerned parents, Chris and Susan helped start the Quincy Youth Basketball Program, a community-based nonprofit. Its objectives were to instill in these young Quincy youths the ideals of good sportsmanship, self-esteem, and respect, and they would become well-adjusted, stronger, happier children who would then mature to become decent, healthy, and trustworthy citizens. The program is now in its 16th year. Thousands of young student athletes in grade 1 through 8 have learned and enjoyed the sport of basketball. Last year, a kindergarten program was added, and this year, the youth basketball program welcomed 4 high school teams into the league. Many of the former youth basketball players have gone on to play ball in high school and college and excel at a higher level. Many local businessmen, elected officials, and families lend their support to further the success of this program. The Quincy Youth Basketball Program has excelled from its inception to provide the best learning experience for the youngsters. They have hosted annual teaching clinics by Harvard University, Boston University, and UMass Boston Women's Basketball Program. Quincy Youth Basketball has offered clinics for coaches at the annual Harvard Coaches Clinic. These clinics feature guest speakers such as Brad Stevens, the coach of the Boston Celtics. Participants from all over the country attend these clinics. Quincy Youth players have also participated in many outstanding tournaments throughout the years. A special highlight for the past 5 years has been the older girls team scrimmaging at halftime during the Harvard University Pink Zone Pack the House game. It's an annual event held at Harvard benefiting breast cancer research. Christopher and Susan Ely, as president and treasurer of the Quincy Youth Basketball Program, look forward with their supporters to the continual growth and success of this program. The Quincy District Court proudly presents the 2017 James R. McIntyre Humanitarian Award to Chris and Sue Ely in grateful appreciation for their commitment to the selfless dedication to the growth, success, and nurturing of Quincy youth through sports and education. Congratulations to Chris and Susan. Rabbi Jacob Mann's Social Justice Award. Rabbi Jacob Mann was the beloved rabbi of the Beth Israel Synagogue in Quincy for over 60 years. He was a very special person and a blessing to our community. Elected officials, judges, court staff, and public safety officials enjoyed his wise counsel, sound advice, and camaraderie. Rabbi Mann enjoyed being invited to Law Day at Quincy District Court. He attended every Law Day ceremony for 48 consecutive years, and his message each time he preached social justice. Quincy District Court honors the memory of this good and holy man each year on Law Day by presenting the Rabbi Jacob Mann Social Justice Award to those individuals or organizations who, by their experience and deeds, best exemplify the social justice teaching of Rabbi Mann. This morning, we are honoring the organization of Dove, Domestic Violence Ended, and I have the executive secretary and these ladies from Dove, representing Dove. From its earliest beginnings approximately 40 years ago, through advocates from the Mayor's Commission on Women and the Office of the Mayor of Quincy, victims of domestic violence and their young family members were given a safe haven, food, in some cases clothing, mentoring, counsel, and advocacy. Dove has done a tremendous job in assisting the most vulnerable in our society. The 2017 honoree for the Rabbi Mann Jacob Mann Social Justice Award is presented to Dove and to its executive secretary, Sue Chandler. Today, Dove continues to care for victims of domestic violence throughout the whole of Norfolk County. Sue, Judge Colvin is now going to say a few words, and he's going to present the plaque to you. So if you just step forward here.
I'm going to be very short. But as all of you know, it's become very popular and appropriate we talk about the opioid epidemic. The District Attorney of Norfolk County, every one of these police chiefs, every police officer in this room can tell you about the epidemic of domestic violence that continues in this state. Domestic violence knows no racial barriers. It knows no economic barriers. It is indeed an epidemic. There's not a night that goes by that we don't have arrests for some type of domestic violence in this area. Victims of domestic violence, where do they turn? They know in the middle of the night if they need to make a phone call, if they need to leave their house, if they need safety, they turn to Dove. And the Jacob Mann Award is a very personal award to this court. And we want to recognize Dove, These people are here every week. We have Dove advocates, legal counselors here at least 2 days a week. I know they do them Dedham Court as well. And I can't tell you how important it is to recognize their continued commitment to the victims of domestic violence. So Sue, congratulations on behalf of Dove.
Good morning. Thank you. This is very meaningful to us. We are privileged to have partnerships with so many of the elected and appointed officials here, the chiefs, so many cities and towns throughout the county, the DA's office. We have a tremendous team at Dove who work very hard with survivors, and we see every single day that it makes a difference. We're appreciative to Secretary Bennett's office for funding that supports some of the work in this courtroom, and also thrilled that Governor Baker's administration has just awarded domestic violence funding to help us prevent some of this by supporting a children's services program that will be beginning this summer. So thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
Before I make a few brief remarks, I'm going to ask the Chief Justice of the Trial Court, Paula Carey, just to make a few remarks, please.
Thank you, Judge Coben. I'd just like to express my welcome to everyone to Quincy District Court. I get invited to a lot of law days every year, and Quincy District Court is one of my favorites. I have to be a little nuanced.
It's my most favorite, yes.
I thoroughly enjoy, and one of the reasons why I do is because of all of the community. It's a real community court. Everyone is rowing in the same direction to accomplish the same end, and it's really endearing because if we're ever going to make a difference in this opioid crisis and in issues such as domestic violence, we all need to be working together across agencies, across branches of government, and it really has to be a collective effort in order for us to make a difference. So I welcome everyone here. Thank you all for coming. Express my congratulations to all of the award winners. It's amazing just what happens in our communities. And also to thank you for being here because it shows your commitment to the rule of law, something that's tremendously important to all of us in the judiciary. It is what sustains us, and it is what gets us through the day. So thank you.
So it's my honor to just make a few remarks and then to introduce the governor. Before I do both those things, I do want to just take a moment to thank both Clerk Magistrate Arthur Tobin and First Assistant Clerk Magistrate Bob Bloom for organizing the event today. I can't tell you how much work, how much preparation goes into this event, and I, on behalf of all of us at the court, want to just give them a round of applause. So last Friday, there was an unfortunate incident upstairs where a couple of some unhappy people got into a big brawl upstairs last Friday. Our court officers, which they're trained to do, intervened. Unfortunately, three of them got hurt, are out this week, nothing serious. Yesterday, when Mr. Bloom and Mr. Tobin were in here organizing over the chairs, over who was going to sit where, I thought another brawl was going to break out and I was going to have to call in the court officers again. But I'll thank you both for everything that you've done. I just want to talk a little about the court. It's a perfect segue from what Chief Justice Carey was saying. You know, every year 30,000 people walk through the doors of the Quincy District Court. They walk in oftentimes with their lives in chaos, and could say, but the majority of time their lives are in chaos. And their families who were seeking help for their loved ones, their father, their mother, their wife, their child, who's in the throes of some type of substance abuse disorder, could be victims of domestic violence, it could be people who are being, families who are being evicted and are about to come homeless. But they come here in their hopes of trying to have their crises answered. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the staff at the court who works day in and day out to help people in very difficult situations, from the clerk's office, who has to address the people as they come to the counter, to the probation department, who actually does the urine test, the drug test, to make sure that people are staying sober and getting people in treatment programs, to the court officers, who not only have to keep security in the building, but now, and Secretary Bennett, you'll appreciate this, have had to bring at least a number of people back to life who have overdosed and died in our lockup, but were saved because of the quick action of these court officers who are right to my right, to the court clinic that evaluates people and finds people placements. I am personally, and all of us are so grateful for the work that gets done day in and day out at the staff. But as Chief Justice Carey has indicated, as a community court, and the Quincy District Court is the essence, I believe, of the community courts. We can't do this alone. We do this in partnership with everyone who has the same care and concern for the people of our seven cities and towns, whether it's the mayors of our town, whether it's the district attorney of Norfolk County, the police, who go out with our probation staff at nights to check on their probationers, to the treatment providers, the shelters, and particularly Father Bill Shelter and Dove. We couldn't do this work without the cooperative effort, including the district attorneys and the private lawyers and the Committee for Public Counsel Services, who represents people here. We work cooperatively towards a common goal of keeping our communities safe and trying to keep the people of our communities safe. So on behalf of all the judges of the Quincy District Court, the clerk magistrates, and the chief probation officer, I want to thank all of you for your cooperative efforts on what we do with this court. So thank you. So I was thinking last night on how I should introduce the governor of the Commonwealth. I was fortunate a number of years ago to serve on a board of directors of the Heller School at Brandeis University with the governor, and I learned quite a bit about him. I learned that he was highly intelligent, that he asked very difficult and incisive questions, that he was always well prepared, that the questions he asked made the presenter a better presenter, and the outcome a better outcome, and that when he came to an answer or a decision, it was always a thoughtful decision. And I realized this guy would make a great judge. Those are all the attributes of a great judge. So Lon, I know you've got an appointment coming up in the Supreme Judicial Court this summer. I want you to consider the governor for that position. So I'm very grateful to the governor for being here today, not only for his willingness to give up his time for being here, but his, for his commitment not only to the courts, but more importantly to what we do in the courts. When I first started as a judge in 1980, and this is true, when I started as a judge in 1989, some of the chiefs might remember this, we had no secure treatment beds, none in the state for women, none. It wasn't until the early 90s that the first five beds were created down at the STAR program in Fall River. Today, because of the governor's work and his commitment to addressing the opioid crisis, which we see here every day, and you could go upstairs and you'll see it today, we have now beds for women in Plymouth, Taunton, Jamaica Plain, Tewksbury. It's a whole different approach. And for that, Governor, we're very grateful for what you and your administration has done. So thank you all very much.
So, do I need to be a lawyer to be on the SJC? You know, he'd be playing himself out of a job on that one. Well, first of all, I just want to start by thanking you all for being here, and I want to thank you for the work that you do every day on behalf of the people of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And to Justice Kerry and Justice Dolly and Justice Coven, I just want to say how much we appreciate the leadership that you bring to your tasks and to your work on behalf of the people of Massachusetts. I also want to thank the DA for being here with us. As a guy who appointed as our public safety secretary a former first assistant in Worcester County to DA Early and a former ADA to the Suffolk County District Attorney, we take very seriously our relationship with the district attorneys and very much appreciate the chance that we've had to work with so many of you on so many different issues, not just in criminal justice, but also in issues like the opioid epidemic and others. I also just want to say hello and congratulations to the former Attorney General, Frank Bellotti. You know, there aren't a lot of people who get a building named after them before they die. but I think that speaks to some extent to how people feel about you, about your service to your country in the military, about your service to this part of the Commonwealth, and about your service to the Commonwealth generally. And by the way, your service to hundreds of public servants who had an opportunity to serve under your wing and to benefit from your knowledge, your expertise, and your willingness to mentor them over the course of your very illustrious and enormously important career in public service here in Massachusetts. Thank you. I also want to thank Governor's Counselor Bob Jubenville for being with us this morning. We've put somewhere between 60 and 70 people in front of the Governor's Council, and I just want to say, and I've said this before, how much we've appreciated the integrity and the respect and the incisiveness of the inquiry that they have brought to their task and to their responsibilities. And Bob, I also want to thank you for your continued guidance and advice with respect to my public appearance. I've really appreciated that, and that's an inside joke between the two of us. You know, Quincy's own John Adams one time said, "We are a nation of laws and not of men," and a good thing too. As somebody who spent about half of my professional career in the public sector at either the state level or the local level, who had a father who served in the Nixon and Reagan administrations, and whose mom, by the way, God rest her soul, was a card-carrying liberal Democrat. Dinner at my house was pretty interesting. Let me just leave it at that, and just suffice it to say that my parents canceled each other's votes out for 60 years, even though they loved each other terribly. I have always understood and appreciated the commitment in this country to the rule of law and how much that means to our capacity to continue to sustain a free society and an orderly one, and one that's based on the rules of the game. Our founders worried a lot about the tyranny of the majority and worked enormously hard to craft a constitution and a framework in which the minority would have an opportunity to be heard, and which anybody who wanted to get anything done was going to have to work their way through that process with respect and find opportunities to collaborate and compromise to move things forward. In my opinion, it's a little messy, but that is as it should be. And thankfully, we have a highly functioning court system here in the Commonwealth that ultimately serves as the referee of many of the disputes that we find ourselves in every single day here in the Commonwealth of Mass. Now, Judge Coven mentioned the opioid epidemic. I didn't run for governor to work on this issue. It sort of found me through the conversations I had with people when I was a candidate. And I truly have never come across anything quite like it, something so devastating and at the same time so broad that affects so many people. I've never been able to be in a room with more than 20 people and have somebody who's not been directly affected by it. And a lot of our work in prevention, education, intervention, treatment, and recovery in this space has been driven by the stories and the conversations we've had with family members, brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, sons, daughters, first responders and people in public safety who have often been on the front lines of this, docs who work and nurses who work in emergency rooms, and folks who work in the court system. And I think it's important on this particular day and on this particular issue that we remember that the first drug court in Massachusetts was established in 2001 in Quincy. Quincy was ahead of its time, once again, with its decision to try to come up with alternatives to incarceration and to pursue diversion and treatment and other forms of support for people who are battling addiction and to find a different path to help them find their way back into productive society. And I think sometimes, as time goes by and history moves on, we forget about the people who started to do things that were sort of far out on the edge when the edge became the middle. And to the folks here in Quincy who were significantly ahead of everybody else on that one, I would just want to say thank you because you blazed a trail that many have followed behind you, and I hope others continue to do so going forward. I also just want to mention briefly, there was another sort of 30-year-old issue that we chose to deal with as an administration, and in conjunction and collaboration with the legislature managed to get it done, which was to turn Bridgewater State Hospital into an actual hospital and to put the rules, the personnel, and the structure in place to have it serve as the forensic facility it was always intended to be. And it is our hope that on a go-forward basis, that institution will actually be able to do the work it was supposed to do in the first place, which was to serve people who were civilly committed and to have them engaged in what I would call a treatment process managed by clinical professionals. We are one of the last states in the country to actually get there on this one, and I'm sorry it took us so long, but I take great pride in the fact that that notion that some of the most troubled people in our society would be served in a facility that was actually more appropriate for them than the one we've been able to make available to them for a very long period of time. Now, as I mentioned, I'm not a lawyer. The Lieutenant Governor is a lawyer, so you should all rest easy with respect to that. But I did look hard and long, along with the LG, to find somebody to serve as our chief lawyer. And in Lon Povich, we found exactly the person who fit the job. And one of the things that comes with Lon Povich, if he's your chief counsel, is a whole ton of terrific lawyers who desperately want to work for the guy. And his ability to attract talent to our administration has made it possible for them to make up for the supreme lack of capacity that I have to understand or appreciate the nuances of the law. But again, in some ways, and I've said this many times, the people you choose to serve with you are a big statement about policy and priority. And in our particular case, if you look at the folks that we've chosen to play some of the most pivotal and important roles in our administration that involve the law and justice and the capacity for the Commonwealth to serve the people in these areas, I'll put our team up against anybody's. And based on the feedback I get from people I talk to every day, I believe they do as well. I also just want to tip my hat while I'm here to our Judicial Nominating Committee. The JNC is not something most people day in and day out know much about or pay much attention to. But what you need to know about the JNC is the Judicial Nominating Committee is made up of a collection of attorneys from across the Commonwealth of Massachusetts who represent a wide variety of points of view, geographies, practices, professional expertise, and all the rest. But they all share a fundamental conviction that they want the courts in Massachusetts to be presided over by spectacular justices who have the capacity, the skills, the life and professional experience, and the judgment to make the right calls in their courtroom day after day after day. And while I don't know how long I'll be governor or Karen Polito will be lieutenant governor, I do know that the people that we nominate and that the governor's council approved to serve on the bench are going to be there until they retire. It's in many respects a legacy decision, and we take it very seriously, and the work that's been done by our JNC, I would argue, is second to none. And the one other point I would make with respect to that, and I say this to people all the time, everywhere I go, you can't nominate somebody to serve on the bench in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts if they don't apply. Do you want me to repeat that one? Because it's really important. You can't nominate somebody to serve on the bench if they don't apply. The quality of the talent that serves on the bench, and I happen to think Massachusetts has terrific talent on its bench, and I'm incredibly proud of the 60 or so folks that we've put in front of the Governor's Council, and I'm especially proud of the folks that we put up before the Governor's Council to serve on the SJC. But we can only do the job we do based on the quality of the folks who apply. And for those of you who are here today, and by your presence, you're making a statement about how important you think the judicial system is, the rule of law, and the courts are here in the Commonwealth. My message to all of you is to make sure that the very best and brightest among us seek the opportunity to serve on the bench and do the people's business. Now, we all sit on the shoulders of those who came before us. And many of them, when they're in the midst of doing whatever it is they do, they're not trying to make history. They're just trying to do what they think is the right thing. And it's history that over time translates what people did and puts it in some sort of framework and context. And the one great thing about public life is you have an opportunity to be part of that history. And it's up to all of us, when we find ourselves in that position, to respect it and to do whatever we can, our very best effort, to serve the people who we've sworn to serve. And I'll give you the best example I can, and then by the way, to move on and to go back to become a private citizen once again, who for some period of time had this chance to play in the public sphere. Now, shortly after, I'll give you an example of what I mean by that. Shortly after I became governor, in the first couple of months is just nuts. You run around with your hair on fire and trying to figure out what's going on. In our first couple of months, we had, 75 feet of snow and the MBTA broke and a few other things like that. And toward the end of one of my days, I came roaring into a meeting in my office, and there was about 15 people in there. And it was a meeting with the Medal of Honor Society because they were going to have their conference in Boston. And they were checking in with the governor to make sure that we could do whatever we needed to do to ensure they were successful in having their event. So I ran around and shook hands with everybody. They all told me who they were and said, "How are you? What can I do for you? Blah, blah, blah." And one older guy looked at me and he said, "Well, it's like a helicopter ride." And I said, "Yeah, I'll make a note of that." So we sit down at the table. We have the conversation. We go around the room. And people are explaining to me what some of the key issues are that they're looking for. And this guy looks at me and he goes, "I really want the helicopter ride." And I said, "Yeah, I heard you the first time." So I basically said, "Look, you're the Medal of Honor Society. You represent the highest civilian award in combat that can be awarded by the United States of America. We'll do whatever we can to support you when you come here. We're just honored you chose to come to Boston." So we finish the meeting, and then we all do this. I take a lot of pictures in the governor's office. So we do this thing where everybody comes up and stands in front of the, in my office, it's John Volpe, because John Volpe was my dad's boss when my dad worked in Washington. Great American, great governor, great transportation secretary. So this guy comes over, and I shake his hand, and he again says he wants this helicopter ride, and I'm thinking, wow. So we're standing there, we're about to take our picture, and he looks up at me like this. He goes, "Damn, you're tall." And I said, "Yeah, I hear that a lot." And he said, "I used to fly with a guy who was about your size. We called him Too Tall." So I looked at him and I said, you know, that's really funny, because there's a guy named Too Tall, actually a Medal of Honor recipient, who got the Medal of Honor for flying in and out of the Vietnam battle at Iadrang Valley, which was the first major conflict between the North Vietnamese and the American military in the Vietnam War. And it was terrifying, horrible, horrible battle scene. And the medevacs stopped flying in because they were afraid they couldn't get in and get out without getting shot down. So Too Tall, Ed Freeman, kept flying in and out, taking out injured soldiers and providing supplies to the men on the ground. And I think his commanding officer that day was a guy named Bruce Crandall. And I know all this because I read a book called We Were Soldiers Once and Young, which I highly recommend to everybody in the room that told this story. And so this guy looks up at me, he goes, yeah, Bruce Crandall, that's me. That's what I said when I came in the door. My name's Bruce Crandall. Now, Bruce Crandall was nominated, fellow soldiers wanted to nominate him to get the Medal of Honor for his role in that combat mission, and he said no. He said, I'm the commanding officer, I was supposed to be there. You should nominate Ed Freeman instead. And so Ed Freeman was nominated for and received the Medal of Honor, and then a bunch of years later, they came back to Bruce Crandall and said, listen, given what you did and how many people you saved and the heroism you displayed that day and the leadership, you really ought to let us nominate you. And he reluctantly agreed to let them nominate him, and he received the Medal of Honor. So in my office is this guy who's just a guy, all right? Older guy, gray hair, blue blazer. Looked like he hadn't worn a tie. He had one on, but it looked like it was the first time he'd worn one in many years. Sort of like my dad. And this guy is a bona fide American hero. Somebody who, when pushed to the limit and had a choice to make about whether to fly in and out of this horribly dangerous combat scene or not, chose not to do it once, but chose to do it over and over and over again, every single time, taking a chance, a big chance that he would be shot down and killed. And he did it because he wanted to help save the people who were on the ground. And he did. Now, he just did his service, tried to get recognition for the people that he served with, and then went back into civilian life. There he was, standing in my office, and all he wanted was a helicopter ride. So after he said who he was, and I knew who he was, I said, look, Bruce Crandall, I know who you are. And on behalf of a grateful nation and a grateful Commonwealth, I just want to tell you how honored I am to be in your presence, and I want to thank you. On behalf of the men and women that serve this country, I want to thank you for who you are and what you represent. And he looked at me and he said, so do I get my helicopter ride or not? So we went to great lengths to provide helicopter rides with a purpose. When these guys came in for the conference, we flew them out to a bunch of high schools and colleges and town halls and had them meet with young people to talk about character and about patriotism and about sacrifice. And it was a beautiful thing. The only curveball in the whole thing was that Bruce got sick and couldn't come. So all the other guys did, but the soldier's humor. So what all the other guys did was they took pictures of themselves in the helicopters and then sent them to Bruce and said, basically, tough darts. Thanks for getting us the rides. We're sorry you can't be here to join us. But I tell that story because, you know, at some point, those of us in public life move on. Retire. You don't get reelected, whatever it happens to be. You serve your community, You serve your Commonwealth. You serve your fellow citizens. And with that, you carry a tremendous burden based on the work and the sacrifice that's been put forth before. But you also have this enormous opportunity to be part of the lineage of over 200 years of great men and women who, when the call came, did the right thing. And those award recipients that you announced today and that you honored, those are exactly what public service is all about. Those are the people who every single day represent what I believe public service is all about and represent the very best among us. I'm sure the Wu family would agree with me on that one. And by the way, I was wearing Mark Charbonnet's sweatshirt yesterday. Just pure coincidence, but I wear it a lot just to make sure I can, so when people say, what's that? I can tell them the story of Mark. But on Law Day, we all have an opportunity to remember that we are a nation of laws and not of men. There are rules. There is history. There is tradition. And there is this opportunity for us to be part of this grand and noble experiment. And we should always remember that among us, anonymous among us, are men and women who, when they had to make the call, made the right decision and will become part of the best part of our history. Thank you.
Ancient tradition here, which began about 4 or 5 years ago, Judge Coven.
Governor, because you've honored us here today with not only your presence and your words, but with your ongoing commitment to the rule of law, the independence of the judiciary, we, on behalf of everyone at the court, we want to present you with this framed constitution.
Awesome. Thank you so much. My 60-year-old eyes will not be able to read this. But thank you very much.
Thank you. Just a second. Before we proceed, I want to acknowledge Quincy Access Cable. They come every year to record this for the people who cannot be here. Standing up there, the cameraman is Mark Crosby. Been coming here since he was a little boy. He's the cameraman. He's the editor. He's the sound mixer, whatever that does. And you'll be watching it on Quincy Cable next week. I want to acknowledge, to those of you who came in the front door, you heard beautiful music outside. That was provided by the Braintree String Quartet. They've been coming here, the Braintree String Quartet has been coming here since the 1980s, and they're with this year by Zoltan Revrovic. Thank you, Mr. Tobin.
I have one more pleasant task to perform. As we stated earlier, all of you make Law Day special. But tomorrow, one of our distinguished guests with us today is having a very special day. And our First Justice, Judge Coven, wishes to recognize this achievement. So if I could have my dear friend, Clerk Magistrate Paterna, who is a longtime friend of our honored guest, could you please escort Francis X. Bellotti, the Honorable, to the podium, please?
Could I ask the Chief Court Officer of the Dedham Complex, Patty Bellotti, to step forward as well, please? So everyone in the room, Governor, you in particular, tomorrow is Frank Bellotti's 94th birthday. From Quincy, Frank. Montilio's. Yeah.
She holds the cake because she runs everything. You know, I didn't realize that that was an accomplishment, but I also didn't realize I was ever going to get here. So this, Governor, I thought what you said was wonderful, and that's why we all respect you. It's a particular honor for me to be here. You know, my wife got sick, and she couldn't climb the stairs, so we moved to Hingham. But you never leave Quincy. I live in Hingham, but I'm still part of Quincy, and I'm still a very important part of this court. I started here, I tried my first case here, and we've had some wonderful chiefs. Judge Prince was wonderful. And no one is better than Judge Coven. He combines everything that we as trial lawyers think makes a wonderful justice. He's intelligent, he's compassionate, and he's given everything to this job. And he's made this court even better. So when I say it's a particular honor for me to be here and to even be recognized, I really mean that, because this court is such an important part of my life that having it named after me is probably one of the most wonderful things that's ever happened to me. So, thank you for recognizing my 94th birthday, and someday you may find out what it feels like to be the oldest guy in the room, no matter where you go. So thank you.
Well, Frank, and when they talk about you in this courthouse, it's the eponymous courthouse. Is that right, Stacy?
That's correct.
Okay. The eponymous courthouse. Look it up. Frank, when you were born in 1923, Warren Harding was the president, and he lasted until August 2nd. When the lying media printed the false fake news that the president had died. In any event, Calvin Coolidge was sworn in the next day. Before? Yes.
When you finish.
I'm finished.
I want to tell one brief Frank Bellotti story. I bumped into him recently and he said to me, "How you doing?" I said, "Fine." "How's Judge Coven?" I said, "Fine." "How's my friend Bob Bloom?" I said, "Fine." He said, "You two are lucky to have him. He keeps that place going."
But they started without me. At this time, I'm honored to call forward Rabbi Mendel Gerkow of the Shiloh House Chabad of the South Area in Stoughton. Rabbi Gerkow.
Good morning, everyone. Honorable judges, His Excellency Governor Baker, police officers, members of the law enforcement, all the honorees of the day, all friends and all guests in this room today. It is my honor to be here to conclude this wonderful event with the following benediction and closing remarks. And it is truly an honor, and I'm humbled by all the honors that have been given here today, all the heroes who are here today, and Mr. Governor, I was very touched by your words. And once again, happy birthday, Mr. Bellotti. Recognizing the fact that our country is based on the words of the Constitution, separating church from state, yet it is still a fact that our founding fathers have served by the influence of a higher power, as evident by the words, "In God we trust," inscribed on every dollar bill. Our judges and our governor come to serve their people every single day in the spirit of the words of the oath that they gave in the name of God on their first day in office. We recognize the fact that God has given us 7 laws for all mankind. Of the 7 laws, 6 of them are laws of thou shall not do. Only 1 is a proactive command, thou shall do. It is obvious that the positive, constructive, and proactive commands are more powerful and more endearing than negative and laws of constraints. The 1 proactive law we have amongst the 7 is the law to appoint judges and officers to enforce these laws. This is a command which we are fully executing today in this courtroom and in every courtroom in this country every single day of the year. So it is in this spirit of fulfilling our duties of the 7 laws of God that we pray to Him and ask to bestow His blessings to all who are here with us today. God of heaven, Master of the world, look favorably upon His assembly of judges and servants of this great commonwealth here in this very historic city. Bless these distinguished individuals, respected by thousands of people who have placed their faith and confidence in them to interpret and enforce the law for them and for their families. Grant us, Almighty God, those assembled here be aware of your presence, and by laboring for the enactment of just laws, they are doing your will. Please, Almighty God, recognize these heroes who are being singled out here today, award them for their excellence, give them and their families the strength to continue to be a shining example upon all those around him. Thank you very much.